You know the Big 12? The winner of the Big 12 in football might like go to the national championship in the playoffs. If you're one of the four teams.
If it's only Oklahoma State's okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, here in just a moment, we're going to be beginning the services. I want to thank all of you for being here. If just a quick reminder, if you have a cell phone or any sort of portable device, you might just check to make sure that's either off or on vibrate. Thank you.
we've gathered here this evening in honor and in memory Dr. John Frederick J. Fred Wilson, who was born July the 12th, 1930, departed this life October the 29th, 2021. I invite you to hear these words from the scriptures. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And the Apostle Paul writes in the book of Corinthians, for we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. You bow with me in prayer. Oh God, you are the Lord of life. And today we are reminded that you are also the conqueror of death. That down through the generations of time, you have been a very present help in time of trouble. You have been refuge and strength for your people. So Lord, as we come to these moments to celebrate Fred's life and faith, I pray simply that you would be the God that you have always been. Be near unto his family here gathered. I pray, Lord, that you would apply the ointment of your spirit to their spirits, that they might find comfort in this time of grief. And Lord, I just pray that you would enable us in these moments to turn our eyes away from the shadows of death, that we might be able to glimpse the light of eternity, confident that you have indeed prepared a place for Fred and for all of those who love you. It is in the holy name of Christ we pray. Amen. And then hear these very familiar words from the 23rd Psalm, written by King David, well acquainted with the realities of life and death. But as I share these familiar words, be mindful not only of the comfort of these words, but take comfort in the fact, I take comfort in the fact that my friend Fred knew the shepherd of whom the psalm speaks. David writes, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hear now another hymn of faith selected by the family.
You dwell in the shelter of the
I invite you to hear these words from Romans chapter 8. Again, this evening we hear them in the context of Fred's life and Fred's faith because these are wonderful promises. The Apostle Paul writes, "All who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption. And when we cry, Abba, Father, it is the Spirit himself bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children of God, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we might also be glorified with him. And I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed to us one day. For we know that in everything God works for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who shall be against us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all of these things we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor height, nor depth, nor powers, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." This is God's word for us today. The Apostle Paul, I think, asks the appropriate question here in Romans 8. At least it's the question that I repeated to myself when I got the call that Fred had passed and they asked if I would come and help celebrate his life and faith, of which, by the way, I'm distinctly honored to do. The Apostle Paul asks, what shall we say to these things? What shall we say to these things? What shall we say concerning J. Fred Wilson? 91 years, lived life, loved life, treasured life, quality moments, saw places and people and events and experiences that some of us may never see in heaven. What shall we say to these things? 91 beautiful years of a life well lived. Now I can pronounce the benediction, go home with that. I think we would all be joyful because, number one, like Fred always liked, the sermon was short. And number two, truthfully, I could never put into words everything that I would want to say. We could never capture in words everything that we would want to express in moments like this. But we do take a few moments, and my own experience, when we take the time to celebrate the life of the person we love, and we take the time to celebrate the God that they served, where those two come together is where we ultimately find our strength and our comfort to be able to continue forward and to be able to move through our grief and even find wholeness on the other side. So just for a moment, I celebrate Fred's life and I celebrate the God that he served. I hope you heard it in the scriptures, the God that he served is a God of peace. Elsewhere, the Apostle Paul called it a peace that passes all understanding, a peace that's able to come even in the deepest times of grief and loss, a peace that shelters us, doesn't take us out of the storms, but shelters us amidst the storms of life. And please note today, we know already, Fred walks into the fullness of what that peace really is today. Struggles here are over. Peace on the other side. Sheltering presence of God. Shelter, when I think of that, we shared many rounds of golf at the Pines together at his invitation, and it was always a joy. I remember one of the first times I went out, two things happened. One, I'm not a very good golfer because I just didn't golf that often. And so I was kind of excusing myself before the first tee and saying, look, Doc, I've not really golfed that much. And he said, listen, there's nowhere on this golf course that you'll hit it that I haven't already been. So take heart. Doc said, okay, that sounds good. So we started the round. You know, I did pretty good on one. I did pretty good on two. I was surprised at the par 33. I got on four, topped it right in the water. He said, I've been there. Thank you very much, Doc. Appreciate it. Teed off, kept going, got all the way to, I think, number six. If I remember right, Mike, I pulled a left and I'm OB. He looked at me and said, I've been there. That's what he said. Always the encourager, you know, along the way. But during that round of golf, a storm moved in. We were over on the backside somewhere. I don't remember. I was in the cart with Fred, and it just started to pour the rain. He goes back and pulls out the largest umbrella I've ever seen. Again, I'm not a golfer. I wasn't accustomed to those golf umbrellas. That he said, do you have an umbrella, preacher? I said, no. He goes, sometimes that's the most important piece of equipment in the bag. And I can remember for probably a good 15 minutes sharing the umbrella with Doc Wilson over there, being sheltered from the storm. Now, I say that really in relationship to peace, because he taught me, and in fact, he said on that day, you're supposed to be the one telling me to be prepared, but I'm telling you next time, be prepared. But he knew where to find shelter, not just there, but friends in life. He knew where to find the sheltering peace and presence of God. That was a part of his life. It was a core of part of his identity. And now he's in the fullness of that shelter. And I simply say to you as family or very close friends, that during these times you also can find your shelter and peace there. That's a promise that God gives us in these times. Secondly, hope you heard it clearly in Romans 8. Fred also worshiped the God of love. The Apostle Paul said, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. You gathered here had the opportunity to experience the love of God in the person of J. Fred Wilson. His family, right off the bat in getting to know Fred, treasures, jewels in his heart. You know that already. I could go on and on about that. I was there, having come to Wesley United Methodist in 1997, during Mary Louise's illness and subsequent death. Was there later, years later, celebrated and officiated at the wedding of Audrey and Fred down at the Hotel Morgan. All of them together then talking about their family. Family, you always have those memories. I had the opportunity with my friend Fred to see his heart full. I had the opportunity to see his heart broken. I had the opportunity to see his heart mended as he embraced a new tomorrow. I had the opportunity to see his heart overflowed every time he talked about one of his family members. It's one thing to get to know a person, it's another to be able to share your hearts. That's always special. And I think one of the ways that God really shows us his love in times like this is through the gift of memory, because death certainly takes away the physical presence of the person we love, but death can never take away quality memories. And please know today, you need to tell those stories to one another. The younger generation, tell some of those stories as well. They're the ones that start. You remember the time? You know, one time we traveled over to, do you remember that time that we, that's how they start. Because those narratives aren't just a reflection of who Fred was, but those narratives are a part of who you are now. That story is woven into your identity. That's the reason I say that I believe, of course, say, well, you're a preacher, of course you believe, it's part of God's gift of love to us. He loves me enough, he loves you enough to let us remember in a way that gives us strength in the long run. Now, trust me, in my own experience, in the beginning, some of those stories are going to make your heart very heavy. But in the long run, they do become sources of strength. So tell those stories. Faithful in church, the 8:30 service. First time I met Fred was at a meeting when I was the new pastor at Wesley Church in 97. And there was a large group of people there. He's very faithful, very concerned and faithful concerning his church. He was on several committees. He even looked at relocating at one time. He had all kinds of visions. Some of you may remember that. And I remember when I came, all these people asking me all kinds of questions, and Fred raised his hand, and he leaned a little bit in, and he said, "I just got one question for you." I said, "What's that?" He said, "Can you save our church?" My God, what a question. Heavy. I didn't know what to say. I said, "Well, maybe we'll talk more about that as we go forward." And you know, he was an 8:30 churchgoer at Wesley United Methodist, and I remember when I started there, if we had 10 or 15 at 8:30, we'd be fortunate sometimes. You know, and then after a few years, all of a sudden we'd have 100, and he would come out and say, "This is great." He'd shake my hand, always appreciative, always grateful. Thank me for the sermon, even the ones I know that were no good. I know he thanked me anyway. He was a grateful heart. He was an appreciative man. And always wanted the other person, I felt anyway, to feel lifted up. And to me, that was wonderful. I'll always have that memory. Men's breakfast. Shoney's, we met. We had men's breakfast, 2 eggs over hardened toast. That was Fred Wilson's order. You say, "How in the world do you remember that?" I'll tell you why, because I always ordered mine over easy. First time I heard him say, "2 eggs over hard," I said, why would anybody order eggs over hard? And he just looked at me and said, "Why would anybody order eggs over easy?" So there we were, sharing our breakfast together. Great sense of humor. One time he came up to me at church, he said, "Man," he goes, "you're not going to believe what happened." And I had only been there about a year or so. He said, I was behind a guy at the cleaners. And he said, I thought it was you. It you split an image. And he said, we had a good relationship. So I went up behind him and just bumped him a little bit. And he said, as soon as he turned around, I realized it's not the preacher. It's someone else. But he had to tell me that. And I said, "Well, anytime I'm in trouble, if you think it's me, Fred, it's probably not. It's probably that other guy." Which reminded me of the great sports fan, as you know. And WVU basketball games, I sit on the floor underneath the basket on the visitor's inside, right on the front. And oftentimes, Fred, in that lower section, right, would be to my right over here, sat there many times. And just like my preaching, this was his comment, "You're more animated at the ball game than you are in the pulpit." And that was true, especially in my younger days. I sometimes had to point out to the referees where they were in error. And I did that quite in an animated fashion. And one time, a little too animated, because a referee came over during the timeout and actually told us to settle down just a little bit. Well, here comes Jay Fred out. He comes down, time down, he comes walking over, shakes my hand, he goes, "He goes, what did you say?" He said, "I've never seen a referee go to the audience and talk to them, much less my minister." And he wanted to know. He said, "What in the world did you say?" I said, "Fred, it really wasn't that bad." The referee was standing right in front of me, and I said, "Listen, you can bring the first string referees out at any time." That was enough for that guy to turn around and take exception. But I'll never forget him saying, "Much less my minister," getting called out at the ball game. I'm sure you could tell many, many stories, many, many things that I remember. But I want to go to the third part, and that is, not only is God a God of peace and love, but he's a God of hope. Because I remember just a couple weeks ago, it was 20 years when my dad died, in 2001. And just one of the very first calls I got was from Fred Wilson. And when I came back from the funeral, it had been about this time of year, a little bit earlier. It's a decent day, very decent day for late October, early November. He called and said, "I think it's nice enough for 9 holes. What do you think?" I said, "Absolutely, Doc, let's do it." "Who's playing?" "Bill Van Boris, on it." "No," he said, "I thought today it'd just be me and you." And it was. I'll never forget that, friends. That's the kind of man your dad was. It's the kind of man your husband was. It's the kind of man your grandfather was. He knew when the preacher was hurting. And he knew what it was to hurt and loss. It hadn't been that long for him. And so we golfed. We talked. Sometimes it was quiet. Other times we talked. Loss, grief. How do you go on? Hit my ball in the woods, I've been there. But when it comes to grief, he'd been there too. And that will forever be a treasure for me. And I celebrate that because that's the hope. That's the expression of the hope that we have. Friends, know today that death does not have the final word for J. Fred Wilson. Death makes us think it has the final word because that's the nature of grief. Death does not have the final word. The final word is always God's word. And God's word is a word of life. It's a word of hope. It's a word of resurrection. Just a couple weeks before my dad died, he had some questions about the afterlife. And I thought, he thought I was a preacher. Maybe I knew all the answers. Not true. But I said to him, Dad, remember the Sunday school stories. And remember, when I would get sick as a kid, Mom would make a bed on the couch so that I could hang out there and be waited on hand and foot. He goes, watch TV. I said, and then when evening came, because I was so sick and tired, I didn't feel like getting up, so I usually just went to sleep on the couch. He said, I remember. I said, then Dad, somewhere in the night after I fell asleep, you came and you picked me up in your arms, and unbeknownst to me, you took me to my own room and tucked me in. And the next day, come morning, I was in my own room and everything was exactly where it was supposed to be. And I told my dad, maybe something like that. God knows when our time here is ended. He knows when we're tired. He knows when we're weary. And in his everlasting arms, our Heavenly Father picks us up and takes us to our own room, the place that he has prepared. And come morning, and if we could glimpse it this evening, this would be very true to all of us, very vividly. Come morning, everything is where it's supposed to be. There is more joy, there's more peace, and there's more love than we ever dreamed or imagined. There's reunions, there's reconnections, there's rejoicing. Friends, Fred Wilson served and worshiped a God of peace, a God of love, and a God of hope. And he has left his memory, his stamp, his identity, his love, his influence engraved upon our identity. So though we grieve, we have much for which to be thankful. I give God thanks and praise for the gift of my friend, J. Fred Wilson. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks and praise again for Fred, for his life, for his love, for his family, for his many friendships, for the care that he exhibited, the love that he showed, the self-giving nature of his character, his integrity that was without question, a word that was his bond, and a faith that persevered. And as we commend him into your care and keeping, give us wisdom to commend ourselves into that same care and keeping. We pray today that you would acknowledge before your throne a sinner of your own saving, a sheep of your own fold, a follower of the Lord Jesus, a disciple of the way. And as you receive him, receive also our prayers for comfort, for peace. Keep us standing upon your promises, knowing that they never fail, but they last into all eternity. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Apostle Paul says that death does not have the victory, that life has the victory. Because we shared many events where the mountaineers were victorious, and we want this to be a celebrative time. I say to us, in mountaineer country, when there is a victory that has been won, we cue Country Roads.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. This is going to conclude our services here tonight. I'm going to ask everyone to remain seated for me, please. I just have a brief comment. Fred, I always, you know, would see him because we're neighbors. And as much as Ken Ramsey said, you know, the way I always pictured him was Fred would disarm everybody because it was always big you, little Fred. He made everybody feel special. Big you, little Fred. What a guy. He was a good guy. Thank you. Now, we're going to dismiss everyone from the rear of the room first, and the people that watched in the auxiliary rooms, we're going to include you. But as we dismiss you, you will have the opportunity, if you wish, to come forward and say goodbye to Fred, because this will conclude the services here at the funeral home. Everyone is invited to join the family tomorrow at the cemetery for the committal in Bridgeport at 11, but there will not be a viewing at that time. And I know a lot of you have had that opportunity already, but we still want to afford you that one more time. If you have not signed a register, please do. Thank you all for coming.